You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I'm joined by a very special guest. I like to go outside of the UK at times, outside of Scotland, but one guest I had to have on when she lamented about her time in Scotland, had to get Debbie Keitel on. So welcome to the show, Debbie.
Hi, how are you?
I'm really excited. I'm getting nervous, to be honest, because I see your character in the ring. I don't know what it is about me. I'm always like, if I see a character in the ring, I'm like, there must be a bit of them in real life. I'm like, oh, a bit apprehensive about messaging or anything like that. But from all accounts, from all I've heard outside the ring, you're a lovely person. So this should go well, hopefully. So we'll break the ice with the bog standard wrestling question of how did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that made you a fan?
Every wrestler's favorite question to ask. I started watching wrestling around 96, 97. My dad was a huge fan, and he used to bring us back tapes from the UK when he'd be traveling over and back for work. I kind of fell off then in the later 2000s, and it wasn't until I was living in New York that I kind of started watching again, and I caught a couple of indie shows, and yeah, that's pretty much it. Yeah, the rest is history.
I usually ask that to like the younger wrestlers because it gives me a gauge of just how old I am. So it's people like going, oh, I remember watching Jeff Hardy, and I go, oh, great. Oh, I remember one of my favorite wrestlers. Yeah, I remember the feud with CM Punk. And I go, no.
Different era.
Yeah, automatically the hair that I have left on my head goes gray, and I just die a little inside. But moving on. So I've heard a couple of interviews from yourself. One that always brought to mind was the Mind of Eat Sleep Suplex Retweet. I think that was around about the time you debuted at Fierce Females, or you're at Source, or around about that time anyway. So, and your story was fascinating for a case of you've had so many jobs that's kind of media related, and then you fell back into wrestling again. And it's just, and there you've been since. You've been pro wrestler Debbie Keitel. So when you started, when you decided to go back and enjoy wrestling and then try and be a wrestler yourself, did you think that how easy it was going to be? Did you have a bit of a athletic background to maybe help you at all? Because I saw 2017 debut after 6 months of training. You must have a good background and at least some rhythm.
Oh, I don't know about that. I think when you have a fire underneath you, and I suppose, you know, time is a factor as well, you're willing to push ahead and do whatever it takes to debut. For me, like, there's nothing easy about professional wrestling whatsoever. You know, I have to work so hard, you know, to be able to do this. It's not something that came naturally, the physical aspect or the athletic aspect. But I was very fortunate to have a background in acting and broadcast journalism. So the talking part came naturally, but the physical part, not so much. So it has taken a long time, you know, for them both to kind of be on par with each other. In terms of athleticism, you know, when I was in my teens, I was a very promising young Gaelic football player, turned very promising hockey player, turned very promising powerlifting champion. So I've always had sports in my background. I love competitive sports. My uncle actually runs a Muay Thai facility in Galway, in the west of Ireland. So my whole family have been involved in rugby, Gaelic football, hockey, you know, you name it, I've been forced to dabble in it. So I do have, I suppose, a competitive sports background, yes.
And they're all very physical sports as well, so not afraid to get hit and at least get in about and throw people about and get thrown about at the same time. So it's all works in with each other, and that hands to wrestling quite transfers quite easily. I say not easily, but you know what I mean, the physical aspect. Yeah. So from then on, you end up, made a debut. I was just noting your opponents that you've faced on the climb up, and it's just seeing where they are now, and just the journeys that everyone's went on, whether it's male, female, or what have you. It's just incredible from 2017 onwards. We did have that debut though. How did you feel? That this is it. This was right. You were then full steam ahead to become the best you could be.
Well, the funny thing is that my goal was to just debut. I never thought anything else would come from it, let alone what I've done to now. So back then, you know, that was the biggest thing for me, is to be able to debut and just have a match. I never could have imagined what would have happened years on from that. Mm-hmm. So it was extremely nerve-wracking, and I was so nervous. And like they always say, like, you'll never be ready for your first match. So it's best to just, you know, when it happens, just get it over with, because where you are for your first match is going to be drastically different to where you are towards, you know, well, not your last match, but, you know, a couple of years from that, you know. So it was really nerve-wracking, but I had worked so hard and pushed so much, you know, for it to happen. So it was a good debut, I think.
I mean, you were in Scotland the year after in 2018. And when I saw clips of you, I'm up in the northeast of Scotland, so getting down to Glasgow to watch wrestling just doesn't really happen as often, because everything's expensive. Seeing clips of you anyway, I also thought that you were around forever, because you were such a complete character, and you were able to interact with the crowd with that background that you've got anyway. But coming over to Scotland from Ireland, I suppose there are two different, rowdy but kind of different crowds. What was it like when you got told, come on over, or what, you fierce females?
Oh, I couldn't believe it. I was so excited, because there had only been really two dominant women's wrestlers in the country at the time, which was Sessionmont Martina and Katie Harvey. So to be able to get that call and be, you know, pulled out of Ireland and brought over to Scotland, it was very, very exciting. And I did not expect the reaction all the Irish girls got when we landed into Scotland. So, it was incredible. It was really good.
There's always been a good relationship between like Scottish promotions and Irish ones, I've found. We're fast forwarding a long, long time ahead, but Community Pro Wrestling are bringing in a lot of Irish wrestlers, which was where you worked just over a couple of weeks ago. So I think it is just because we've kind of got similar philosophies, maybe, the Ireland and Scotland when it comes to wrestling. How would you find like the differences between the two crowds, if any?
I think what's great now is that most promotions, or, you know, training schools / promotions, are focusing on creating those relationships across seas. Because what works for Fight Factory, or, you know, the School of Irish Wrestling, also works for CPW. So it's creating that close-knit group of people where you can exchange talent and, you know, provide opportunities in Ireland and Scotland. So, you know, just to touch on that, I think that's great the way a lot of promotions are looking at doing that now. In terms of difference of crowds, I mean, let me tell you, the Scottish crowd aren't afraid to tell you how they feel. I remember wrestling, I think it was Reckless Intent, and I came out with the coffee cup, and after the show, this a load of kids queued up to, you know, get autographs, and one of them turned around and he said, "Debbie, I'll take you for a Costa after the show if you're afraid." So, you know, not afraid to approach you anyway.
Absolutely. And speaking of coffee, we did get a couple of coffee. I know that you love coffee. It's very well documented. One of the people I spoke to recently on the podcast was Sammy Joe, when we're speaking about grassroots wrestling in Scotland. And again, another memory I've got is seeing the photos of the giant Costa cup and you getting aghast, because it was tea that was inside.
It was tea, yeah.
Do you work at all in that kind of? Did you get inspiration at all from anyone, particularly in wrestling or in entertainment, that you can bring into your character and what you do in the ring.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, Joanna Lumley in Absolutely Fabulous, her character Patsy is a huge, you know, is a huge, huge inspiration for the character of Debbie. You know, your standard, you know, children's villain, like for instance, the nanny in Adam's Family 2, her name was Debbie, and she's just this absolutely vile human being. So I pull, you know, a lot of my character, you know, Debbie's characteristics are pulled from movies and films. I'm a huge film buff. So a lot of Tarantino, lots of, you know, Scorsese, you know, I tend to kind of pull a lot of my kind of characteristics from movies.
And you finally got to be Patsy, Eve, yeah, recently in Multiverse Rumble.
Well, no, I got Stokely and Eddie. AV got to be Patsy for a change. Right. So, yeah, we thought the dynamic would be funnier if she went out as Patsy because, you know, it would be very expected for me to be Patsy.
Of course. Is that all your dreams come true just in one moment then? Even though you didn't get to be Patsy, but was that just an error bucket list ticked off?
Oh, like, you know, behind the curtain, I was Eddie immediately. I was just in character. And then AV had never even seen an episode of Absolutely Fabulous. So she was backstage on Instagram Reels, Googling AbFab and like watching Patsy's mannerisms. And I was like, she's just doing a crash course study on this character just as our music was playing.
Speaking of tag teams, we'll speak about Anita Vaughn in a moment. One that I've definitely got to bring up is the Woke Queens. Mm-hmm. And the now Lyra Valkyria, NXT Women's Champion, just humble clang in there. But seeing the Woke Queens, was Lyra someone that they kind of just clicked with you initially, like straight away, and you got each other? Because I remember you had a match on, I think it was streamed on Facebook for ICW, their Square Go pre-show, and you guys were just a riot in that. Against Angel Hayes and Kaylee Ray. So yeah, as a team, was the chemistry just there straight away?
No, I think the best tag teams have no chemistry in the beginning because you have to kind of feel each other out. You have to kind of find out what the balance is, you know. And with Lyra, you know, she was the technical wrestler. She was, you know, that was her forte. For me, it was the character, the branding, the promos, the talking, and all that kind of stuff that was me. And when we first started working together, we were kind of trying to see how we can combine the two. And then after our first match, we were like, okay, there's definitely something here. We just need to figure out the balance for it. And eventually we realized that she brought out the better wrestling in me and I brought out the talking in her. So it was just a match made in heaven towards the end of it. Now, a shame it had to come to an end, but they were genuinely one of the best years for me in wrestling, for sure.
And I suppose all that work that you guys put together, she's thriving in NXT just now, and that's a very much a heavy character base with the wrestling as well, trying to combine. Yeah. So the Woke Queen years are still living on through yourself and through Lyra as well. Yeah. Another one to bring up, we'll speak about Anita. So you're now the gals.
Yes.
The gals with Anita Vaughn. Again, was that another one that took a little bit of work to just find where the gelling was and where you could slot into place?
Yeah, absolutely. With AV, she hates what I call her Anita, so I'm going to call her AV. Okay. She's outside of the ring, you know, in her everyday life, you know, she's a super strong person. She genuinely is her character. Like, she's very like strong. She's, you know, she's vibrant. She's energetic. She is like an energizer bunny. She is just like on another level. Like, you think I'm bad when I down a coffee, like AV is like that permanently, just high energy all the time. And when we first got put together, you know, we kind of were trying to figure out the dynamic because we found ourselves in a position where the roles were reversed because, you know, she was still getting experience. So all of a sudden I'm the wrestler of the tag team and she's the promo of the tag team. And it was just a new dynamic compared to Woke Queens. But again, we both complement each other in our own ways. We both talk, which is fantastic. We both do the wrestling, which is fantastic. So it's just about, we've been kind of figuring out our dynamic in terms of, well, she's the strong one and I'm the mouthy fast one, you know? So it's another combination that seems to be working for us anyway.
How have you found the wrestling has changed since the shows were taken off because of COVID? Have you found that there's now we mentioned like the companies are now getting a bit more closer together and able to exchange talent. Have you found that that's been one of the biggest changes, or have there been particular changes that you've noticed since shows returned?
I just think wrestling is fun again. You know, for pre-COVID, everything was so serious, you know, and well, not that it shouldn't be serious, of course it should be serious, but I just genuinely didn't always see people walking back through the curtain happy. You know, it was always self-critical, so not negative, but, you know, I don't really recall ever seeing people happy after a match, you know, and I think now when something like that gets taken away from you, you truly do care about it so much more. So, like, when you get to do it, you're just so grateful that, like, even if something goes wrong or something didn't go quite right or you went over, you went under, whatever the issue is, I see people come back from the curtain smiling now and just genuinely happy and grateful. And you can genuinely see people enjoying themselves and having so much fun in the ring now and not worrying about, like, what's next, you know? Everyone is just, I think, enjoying it for what it is now, you know?
I think that's the same case for fans, because I know when I my first show back that I went to, and I got to hear the usual ident sting that they play at the start, like, don't hit the wrestlers, don't swear, etc. and all that. I was like, a wee tear in my eye going, I've missed this. This is the best thing ever. As a fan, and it's, you don't realize how much you miss it. I mean, my wife is the same. She doesn't like watching it on TV. Doesn't care about that. But she'll go to a live show, and even she was thinking, "God, I've missed going to the wrestling." And it's just, like I said, not taking things for granted. And I suppose for when you're saying you accelerated your career to try and get in the ring as soon as possible, that's 2 years that was taken away from you. And now you've got to try and claw them back somehow in some form or fashion. And you've certainly done that. I've, again, looking through the old cage match profile, just seeing match after match after match.
Cage match is incorrect. I just want to put that out.
Cage match is always incorrect, but at least gives me a little remit to work from.
Every time I check my stats on cage match, I'm like, where are all these matches that I've done and, like, clawed my way through, and they're not here, you know? That's a conversation for another day.
I'm putting that on promotions because a lot of them, Scottish ones anyway, they come from our site, it seems.
Yeah.
And if promotions don't put out results, how are we supposed to know? That's the kind of
thing. Yeah.
And I'd hoped when shows came back that social media and on promotions would get better. And some do, but some like to keep their results all squirreled away and never get seen. Which, you know, that's again, conversation for another day. That's something that bugs me about wrestling. We got a bunch of questions in, so we'll go through those before we wrap up here. Right, so I need to find them. I need to read them because they're really small. So we've got Judas Gray. I don't know if you've come across Judas Gray yet. He's asked, can I join the gals?
Yes, because he's a fashion king. So we'd accept Judas Gray into the gals. Yeah, he's got the pose down as well, you know. So
I just wish he would stop throwing stuff at me at shows. That would be lovely. So a show in December, he threw his massive furry jumper at me, and I couldn't believe how heavy it was. And just this past weekend, he threw one of his one of his shirts at me, and I thought, thank God, at least it's lighter. That was nice. We have Formula Ryan 21 with, what's the favorite match of your career, and what's your favorite match as a fan?
Oh, favorite match of my career. I'd have to say the first stadium match against Eshamon Martina, where she beat me for the OTT Women's Championship. That match, just, I think every wrestler has a moment where they realize, like, oh, this is going to be my stairway to heaven. You know, this is going to be the match, you know. And I knew the minute I walked out and I was standing in the ring looking across from her, and I just knew immediately, I was like, this is already going to be an unbelievable match, and the bell hasn't even rang yet. And it was. It was really fun. My own personal favorite. Oh, there's so many. Are we talking like now, or are we talking, you know, when I first started wrestling?
Well, it says right. No, that's a different question. Your favorite match as a fan. So is any that you would go back and watch and just rewatch off whatever YouTube or streaming platform that...
Well, my go-to, because I love tag team wrestling, is always the On Americans versus Booker T and Goldust from... What is it? No Way Out 2002.
That was the most random match. I was not expecting that to come out.
Yeah, it's such a good match. Of the obvious, Victoria versus Trish Stratus, the hardcore match, that's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the greatest wrestling match of all time, which is The Rock versus Hulk Hogan. There's so many. Bret Hart versus 1-2-3 Kid. Literally anything X-Pac has ever done. Mankind, literally anything he's ever done. Mankind versus The Undertaker. There's so many.
I did read that you're a big fan of X-Pac, and he was one of those guys that I don't think I appreciated when I was younger. And then when you go back and watch him, or watch OSW Review, for example, if you watch them back and you go, God, X-Pac was amazing. He was just
absolutely incredible. Yeah, so good.
He's also one of the nicest wrestlers I've ever met as well. I've got two autographs from him because he didn't like the promo pick I picked, because he had a load of them. And I picked a six one, and he went, no, you don't want that one. So he signed it and then gave me another one and signed it as well. And I was like, you're always going to be like top five favorite wrestlers just for that interaction alone.
Oh, like, he's such a nice person. I've been on two shows with him, and I always get a picture. I try and like document things backstage, you know, and I got a picture with him, and he was like, oh no, that's a terrible picture, like, let's get another one. And he found the lighting and he was like, this is the picture. I was like, okay.
I wish I did that, because he did the exact same with me, but I was that nervous, and I was just like, no, it's fine. I moved on.
Yeah, it's fine. And then you're like blurry.
It's a terrible picture, but you know, it's the memory that's there. We have a Chris Moretti. Oh, sorry, Moretel. I apologize, Chris, for saying your name so badly wrong. What is your biggest or main goal in wrestling right now?
I would have to just say to be open to everything that comes along and not just focused on one end goal, because I think, you know, prior to COVID, I kind of focused on one thing and put all my eggs in one basket, and then I didn't really appreciate everything else that was happening, or I took for granted opportunities that, you know, I didn't think I needed. Whereas now I'm just open to absolutely everything. April now? It's only April, and this has been the best year of my wrestling career, and it's only April. I don't know what's in the air. I don't know if it's something in me, but I'm just truly enjoying wrestling again. I'm going to be popping up in new places all over the country, all over the UK, all over Scotland, all over Europe, possibly America and Canada, and it just... you know, I don't know what it is, but the more I stay open to what might come, you know, the more it seems to be happening. So that's my that's my mantra for the year, is just be open to everything.
Great one. I'm about to ruin that by giving you Ian Skinner's question, though. So I don't know if you've heard this question before or been asked it, but he's written it down, so I will ask it. Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games, and no games?
What?
I know. I think I've read it out wrong as well. It's we'd rather have a limited bacon but no more games, or games, limited games but no games.
Oh, I'm just...
I know. That's your brain broken.
I don't know what to say to Mr. Pure Energy Ian Skinner here, but I'm going to go ahead and say no comment, because I think that's a safe response.
That's probably the safest response. That's fine. So, looking ahead, you mentioned that you're just open to experiences this year, and wrestling is incredibly open nowadays, with the things like TNA having their gut check over here, which sounded incredible from the wrestlers I've spoken to about it. I've got Noah coming over here. WWE's coming over to the UK again as well. Speaking of WWE, of course, you had your very brief match with Rhea Ripley, one of the hottest wrestlers in the world right now. Is a rematch? Are you hoping for a rematch on the horizon?
You never know. She's incredible to work with. She's genuinely a really, really amazing person. And while my stint in NXT was short and brief, you know, she really made it for me. Like she was one of the people that was really pushing for me in there. So I'll always be super grateful for that. And what she's doing now is just, she is, you know, the wrestler, you know what I mean? Like she's everything that women want in wrestling. You know what I mean? So she's an idol. She's an icon. She's amazing.
And this will be going out afterwards, after the fact, but she'll be facing Becky Lynch at WrestleMania, which is, I suppose, a hometown favorite for yourself, I would assume. It doesn't have to be, but I assume it is. So seeing someone like Becky make it to the main event of WrestleMania and being in this big matches, get a book and all that, is that the maybe end game? Is that the end goal, to be in that kind of trusted position?
I mean, it would be incredible and it would be amazing, but for me, there's no end goal. We're always evolving. We're always changing. Things, you know, might turn around and go on a different path. You never know what's going to happen. But, you know, to say that would be a dream, it would be an incredible dream if that was to come true or to ever happen. But Becky is an inspiration for not just Irish women, but just for everyone in Ireland in general. What she's done and what she has made of herself is just incredible. She is genuinely untouchable. She's one of the best to ever do it.
And if you mentioned there's places you may be going to, is there any wrestlers in the or anywhere actually in the world, because we're open the forbidden door, that's the phrase nowadays, is there anyone that you would want to take off that bucket list? I mean, X-Pac's probably still, he still has a match or two if that was ever a possibility, but is there anyone that you'd love to get in with?
There's so many. Are we talking, you know, on the indies? Are we talking, you know, up there?
It could be, like I say, we're in a world now where it could literally be anywhere. We're seeing WWE stars going over to Japan. We're seeing AEWs everywhere as well. Mm. It's an insane time to be a fan that we could possibly see huge stars just on our doorstep. So, yeah, the floor's worldwide. Who's up there in your bucket list?
I would absolutely love to work with Serena Deeb. I think she's incredible. I'd love to work with Deonna Purrazzo, Jordan Grace. You know, I'd love to get in there with Danny Luna again. It's been years. There's genuinely so many people that I want to work with. So I'm just open and willing to work with absolutely anyone. But they would be my bucket list people, I guess.
Perfect. Well, before we wrap up and I ask you for all your social media handles, what's the perfect coffee?
What's the perfect coffee? See, this is very tough, right? So I am a black coffee drinker, and that's not to everyone's taste, but I do like to dabble and mix it up sometimes. And unfortunately, south of Ireland, we don't have Tim Hortons. Now, Tim Hortons is like crack for me, okay? Because it's like, when you can't have it, it's all you want, right? But if it was there in front of you, you'd drive straight past it. So anytime I go to Scotland or anytime I go up north to Belfast, it's literally the first place I go to and it's the last place I go to before I go. I love a Tim Hortons French vanilla latte. I think it's chef's kiss. It's stunning. It's everything a girl wants and more. But on the regular, I drink black coffee. I think you only like coffee if you drink it black, because if you have to turn it into a milkshake, you don't like coffee.
Well, just disappoint you at the end here. I don't like the taste of coffee. So it does, you can jazz it up as much as you want. It's still going to taste like coffee to me at the end of the day. And it's like, no.
A lot of people don't like it because it is a bitter taste. It's like I don't really drink, but I know that I cannot stand the taste of red wine. I think it's vile, but then it's an acquired taste. It's a bitterness. And I think you have to kind of develop a palate for it. And I think, because I only started drinking coffee when I turned like 22, 23. I never drank coffee before that. That's just my cat who has decided.
Just coming in to go wrap up. Come on.
Just, yeah, he's saying it's dinner time. It's time to wrap it up. But that's the second cameo he's made in an interview recently. And that's my cat, George Michael. I know.
If we had the time, I'd have so many more questions. But
yeah.
but he's telling us, no, we need to go. But yeah, I'm a child. I drink hot chocolate when I go to Costa or anything like that place.
Hey, that's okay. That's okay. Hot chocolate is good too.
I like to join in, but I don't like to taste the coffee. So anyway, this has been an absolutely fantastic show. I'm so glad that we were able to find time and get in the book and all that stuff. Where can people find out more about Debbie Keitel? Where do people need to go?
Oh, well, you can go to Instagram, the Debbie Keitel, or you can go to Twitter, Debbie Keitel. And for anyone in Scotland, I will be back at CPW on June 22nd.
Perfect. Wonderful. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much. Take care.